Hey guys, we have today Mitja Dolinček, who is the CEO and founder of True Pursue, a company that deals with helping people get a better lifestyle, you know, and they also do NLP. So that means they will teach you how to use NLP to better influence yourself and to better influence other people, as well as build a better lifestyle, with whether it be diet, productivity, or just getting shit done. So thank you, Mitja, for showing up. And what we wanted to talk about today was actually health. So as you know, my health is currently not in the best of situations because I just work so much. So this is also an opportunity for me to get a lot of value from you because obviously having good health is extremely important to actually run a good business. You know, you can't think straight if your health is not good. So first of all, if you want, you can give us like a quick introduction and then we'll get more into the actual health topic.
Okay, so the introduction would be, you know, there are three main parts. It's like oxygen, then it's what you drink, so it's water intake, and the third thing is food. And then we have, you know, exercises. So those are the three main things, and then there's the exercise part. So that's what we're going to talk about. So we're going to start with oxygen, then move through water, food, and then exercise. So that's the basic plan.
That's kind of weird because I never heard anybody talk before about oxygen. Like, okay. I've had many, you know, you go to a fitness coach, she says you should work out more. You go to a dietitian, she says you should eat less or eat better. But I never heard that thing. Like, you should breathe better. Like, what does that mean?
Yeah, so the thing is that most people breathe wrong. And if you breathe wrong, you get less oxygen into your blood. And what that does, it lowers your overall energy. And, you know, it decreases everything that you do about productivity, you know, health-wise, everything along those lines. So what we can do is, if you look at that baby who's just born, you'll see that it breathes from the diaphragm. So only the stomach moves, whilst, you know, most of the people breathe from their chest or, you know, they talk only from their throat. So that's what most singers do. They breathe from the diaphragm. So they're doing it the correct way. And most of the other people do it from their chest. So they're very limited by that. And the majority of your blood vessels are actually, you know, lower, and most people don't use them. So, you know, it's just go to waste. Like the best part goes to waste, but you're not breathing with your diaphragm and only breathing through your chest.
Yeah, but I work like, you know, 18 hours a day, and I'm all day long. It's like I have various interruptions and things I need to be focused on. You know, like most people, it's a very dynamic life. So how would you recommend going about getting better at breathing? First of all, how do you do it? And secondly, you know, how do you keep doing it in this crazy life?
Okay, so Robbie, you teach productivity and how to build habits. So this is, you know, the same. This is like building a habit. So mm-hmm. The way to build it is, you know, you keep interrupting the pattern and, you know, reminding yourself that you're doing it wrong. So just like you learn it the wrong way, now you have to unlearn it and do it the correct way. So what I suggest my clients is that they set like a timer, like every 15 minutes, and it just beeps. Like it doesn't interrupt you so much while you're working, or just a nudge or something that will remind you that you're doing it the wrong way, and then just correct it. And if you think about it, if you get interrupted like every 15 minutes, like for a week, I mean, you will learn how to breathe correctly. Like it's every 15 minutes. So I think that's the way to start.
I like that. So you're saying that you basically do that for like a few weeks.
Yeah.
It's not even interrupting you. And then the upside is that for probably the rest of your life, you know, if you keep at it, you'll be breathing properly.
Exactly.
Meaning you take, by what you say, you take like 50% more air.
Yeah, yeah.
In a lifetime, which will probably be very beneficial to you.
Yeah, yeah. It's like a very simple thing to do. And once you do it, it increases your overall health by a lot.
Yeah, I did go to a lot of cool festivals, you know, like these desert festivals where you do like breathing exercises and all sorts of, you know, working on your chakras and shit. And I always go there and get into this meditative state. And I just start breathing from my belly. And then I noticed I just become more focused, more charismatic. I just become much more relaxed. It's incredible. But then, you know, I come back to the office and I just forget all about it. So I believe that could actually be really good.
Yeah, so most people breathe from, you know, when they're consciously focusing on a breath, like when they're meditating, they're doing it. But, you know, once they go somewhere else, they completely forget all about it. So that's the thing they should fix, you know, all the time, because they're much more relaxed. They're not nervous. They talk maybe a little bit slower. They're a little bit more grounded. So their voice would not be, you know, high pitched or fast or something like that. So it has a lot of benefits. So I think everybody should start doing that.
Okay. What would your next recommendation be? Because you said it's breathing and then.
Yes. Okay. So the next recommendation would be water intake. And that's based on the fact that 70% of our body is based on water. So, you know, most American diet consists only like 15% of water. So, you know, that's like pure suicide. Like you have 70% and you're doing it 15%. That's like a big stretch. So they should really do something about that. So what I recommend the most, and that's very easy to do, is that right after you wake up, like the first thing you do is drink half a liter of water, like the whole cup all at once, because your body is the most dehydrated right after you wake up, because you were sleeping like for 8 hours. I hope that you sleep for 8 hours, because that's also very important. But like after you wake up, you have to drink, because that's when the body is the most dehydrated. And I hear most people say, like, you know, I'm not thirsty. But it's like, if you're thirsty, like if you're a little bit thirsty, that means you're already dehydrated. So if you're just a little bit thirsty, you're already doing something wrong. Okay. So that's not good. And, you know, the way I do it, that's like a little bit of advanced tip. So you're basically setting up the conditions so that the thing you want to happen, which is you drinking water like the first thing every morning, happens to you automatically. So the way to do it, maybe just have like a bottle on your nightstand, so there's no way you can forget it. So you just wake up, you see the bottle, you drink it. There's no way you could do it wrong. Okay, so that's what I would do.
I actually have this really had this really bad habit where every morning I would drink chocolate milk. Now, okay. I used to drink chocolate milk since I was, I think, 4 years old. And this kept up until I was 20. So I would just drink every morning. I would look for that chocolate milk. It was like a habit. And then I became more and more conscious of, you know, eating drinking milk and actually the importance of drinking water. And since then, I basically took out the chocolate milk. And now it's like very easy to just go straight to the water. So at first it was like, you know, because you want that sugar on the morning, but it doesn't give you energy. You know, it just sort of gives you like a quick sap of energy. And then when I started drinking water, it's like you don't get that quick energy, but you also don't get like the dip. So you're just sort of on a very consistent line of energy throughout the day.
Yeah, exactly. You know, you're basically showing here the power of habit. So if you keep doing it, it just becomes normal. It just becomes your standard. But once you switch that, maybe water doesn't taste as good, obviously, as a chocolate milk. But once you keep doing it for like a month or two, that becomes a new standard. So it's much easier to do. And that's one of the things that you teach, like the power of habits. It just becomes natural. You know, you could just forget it and still do it. So it doesn't take like a conscious effort. You just do it.
Yeah. And you know, when you have like the habit of drinking chocolate milk, then you drink water and then it's like the most disgusting thing ever because it's not as good as chocolate milk. So you want to drink like orange juice and you want to drink, you know, anything that has sugar in it. But then when you get used to just drinking water, not only does water taste like really good, you know, you actually very much enjoy it. But actually when you do get to drink that orange juice, for example, it's like five times sweeter because your brain is not used to it anymore.
Exactly. It's like counterintuitive decisions that, you know, you're naturally driven to want, you know, sugar, fat and salt. And most people do it all the time. And if you do that, you know, counterintuitive decision to drink water or to, you know, like we'll cover it next, like eat raw broccoli instead of a Big Mac. You know, that raw broccoli would taste like the worst thing ever in this world. Well, Big Mac tastes so good, but once you get used to that and you create a habit of, you know, drinking water, eating healthy, and then once upon a time when, you know, you do like a big project and you reward yourself with a Big Mac, it's just so beneficial. You reward yourself, so it's like a good kind of, you know, bad meal or a cheat meal, but it tastes so much better because you're now used to raw broccoli, which doesn't have like a, you know, like a lot of sugar, fat, salt that you're naturally wired to want. Okay, so
absolutely, that's right. Yeah. Since I had your coaching session, since you coached me, I think it was like 3 weeks ago, I basically cut out all sugar. So my broccoli, for example, I said, okay, let's go, you know, let's go hardcore. So I just didn't put any salt on my broccoli, which I love doing, like putting a lot of salt. And at first, yeah, it was like, you know, empty taste. And now it's like the best thing ever. I'm like, literally, like people are addicted to Cheetos. You know, I'm addicted to broccoli because it's so good.
That's a good thing to have. And that's one of the things I like most about you. You were like, I said, like, cut all the dairy products. And you said, you know what? Like, this cheesecake is now in the trash. Like, 15 seconds later, you did everything that I told you not to do. Like, in 15 seconds, you just threw it in the trash. So,
Yeah. Because, you know, by working a lot and by having a business, you basically learn that you and other people, we're all just basically dumb. And you give us, like, let's say you give me like 10 minutes between the time you talked about dairy products not being good to the time, you know, I thought about throwing out the dairy products. If I don't actually throw them, after like half a day, whatever we talked about, it's forgotten. You know, so it's like, I did it anyway. So, it's a funny story because while we had the conversation, you're like, no, dairy products are really bad. And of course, I believe we'll get to that later. Yeah. And I just looked at the dairy product. I had like cheese or something. And I was like, oh God, so little left. If I just like eat a bit more and then it's done and no more. And then I was like, fuck it, no, threw it in the garbage, you know, like with the cheese, with everything. And thankfully, you know, back then I had an arrangement where I was living with people, but right now I'm living by myself. So when you live by yourself, you can really just customize whatever you bring home. So I just don't bring any milk, any cheese. I just don't even touch it. My rule is that if it's like refrigerated, then it's bad. Unless it's like maybe like frozen vegetables or something. And also I was really affected by, you know, the session we had, you know, we talked about meat. So I still do eat fish. But regarding regular meat, I don't know. You affected me a lot. Maybe it's like all that NLP coaching you had. But I really looked at meat, you know, in the supermarket, and I'm like, oh God, this is a dead animal with like germs in it and it's rotten. Oh, I don't want it. I don't want it. I just don't touch it. And actually, I'm feeling actually better, you know, just keeping it clean, like fish and vegetables and fruits and, you know, clean stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
One last thing regarding water. This is the ultimate office thing. So this is much bigger than it looks. This is literally bigger than my head and it weighs like a lot. So I just put, instead of always having to get water, cause that, you know, that sucks. Cause, sometimes, you know, you just work and you can't afford getting water right now. So I just bought this beast and it literally has water, like 4 or 5 bottles. It will last. I mean, this is after like 2-3 days. And I drink a lot, like I drink, at least like 8 cups a day, at least. And, this makes sure that you actually drink. So for anyone listening who's working in an office environment, especially if you're working 18 hours a day like me, this is a must to keep healthy. Because if you're working so much a day, you're probably so passionate that you'd rather finish that project before you go drink.
Yeah, so another thing... You're really setting up all the conditions, like you said. You don't buy the things. So you don't watch, you know, like cheese all the time in your refrigerator. So that really lowers your willpower. Of course, when every time you open a fridge, there's like meat, cheese, and all the things that you crave naturally. Mm-hmm. Like who would pick the raw broccoli then? so that there's no way if you watch all that things like your whole day. So it's very hard. So if you just set up the conditions, so there are no cheese and meat and all those things in your like environment, there's no way you can do it.
So this kind of goes back to success in general, you know. You want to be successful, you want to create the conditions, you want to come from the mindset that, again, we are all dumb creatures and most of what we'll say we won't do unless we have no choice. So if you want to be successful, you know, have what, for example, become a millionaire, you have to ask yourself, how do I create a situation where I don't have a choice?
Exactly. And I think that's the problem. Like you know, the enemy of great is not bad. That's good. Like you're okay and you're like average.
I want to make sure we rephrase that because I'm not sure people got it.
Okay.
You said the enemy of the best is the good.
Okay, yes. It's like that. So yeah, that's the problem because like you gave such a good story when you said like on a previous webinar, like, what if somebody kidnapped your family or something and you had to like get $1 million in like 30 days and you're broke right now? So you're pushed in a situation that you have to do it. And I think that, you know, the people that would be so motivated, they would do it. And it's the same thing in all areas. So it's in health. Like if I told you like you have like cancer and all sorts of bad like conditions and you have to quit all the smoking, all the meat and everything, some people would be, you know, so motivated that they would do it, but most would be still that hardwired, like I have to stay consistent, and they still wouldn't do it. Like it's simple, but it's not easy. You know, I could just say like, you know, run for 1 hour every day and drink lots of water. It's very simple. It's like one sentence. And still most people don't do it.
They don't even do like 5 minutes.
Yeah. So you have to keep things into perspective, you know, like Ty Lopez says, you know, Arnold Schwarzenegger trains for 6 hours every day. Like he did that for decades.
You can do it
15 minutes. Okay. So, you know, like it's very simple compared to what he's doing. Mm-hmm. Okay, so
I believe it was 5 hours, but it was 6 days a week.
Okay, so it's still very much compared to what others want to do.
Oh, just 5 hours? 5 hours is not a lot. That's a bit. I can do 5 hours.
Yeah, exactly.
And again, I believe he only worked 5 hours because if he worked out more, then literally he found out that that's his limit, like before his body collapses or something.
Yeah, that's like an extreme.
Cool. But, so we talked about breathing. You said that's you basically the way I feel like you're positioning this is like we have like a triangle and that's like the foundation.
That's so like the most important and the easiest, and it's water, which is still very easy to do compared to, you know, food that we'll cover later. That's like a tricky one, but you know, still you have to build.
So you're saying if you for any reason are not satisfied with your health or even want to just improve it, first thing you should do is the foundations, again, like in any business. And you're saying, okay, first of all, take care of your breathing. Secondly, take care of your water intake. And that would be like the biggest instant benefit to your life because you can instantly start drinking more water and breathing better.
And exactly.
Take care of like the more complex subjects that have lower returns too. So, so if you eat like an amazing diet, and if you eat like a, you know, not shit diet, but like an average diet, that would only have like a 20% difference. But if you like breathe properly, that would have like a huge difference.
Yes. Like you could eat, like average, and by average, I don't mean American diet, but you know,
that's like whale diet. It's not American.
Yeah. It's like average, but if you drink lots of water with it, it's like no problem. If it's like 50% or 60% water, it wouldn't be a problem. But the problem is because like Big Mac and, you know, French fries and all this, and then you don't even drink water, you drink Coca-Cola or something like that. That's the problem. So if you would just drink lots of water, so all this waste would go out of your body through water, you know, it wouldn't be so bad. It would still be bad, but you would really improve still, you know. That's I think the best thing about health, because, you know, most clients that I have, that they just want to like the first thing they want is, you know, money. And I think like to myself, you don't get it. You have to fix the physical, emotional, and then you can go on mental, because you always be limited by physical and your emotions. Like those are the main things. Before you don't have these two things fixed, you will always be limited, and your results will be very limited by that. So
it's like a bottleneck. It's like you have this thing, and it's like, let's say your health is like this good. So that's your physical. So no matter how much effort you put in, it'd always be limited to this amount of effort. But let's say you do work on your health, then it will be like this much, and then you could put the full amount and you wouldn't have like that choking point.
That's a great analogy, yes. That's a great one.
Cool. So I like what you're saying. So basically the levels are, first of all, take care of your breathing, then take care of water intake, because that will help with the, you know, the taking out all the bad things in your body and keeping you hydrated. And then third thing you're saying, don't focus on necessarily on the good food, but focus on not eating shit.
Mm-hmm.
Like starting out.
And yes.
Where would you put exercise in that category?
I would put exercise in between water and food. Because exercise, I think it's like more important than food, because if you don't exercise, the waste keeps, you know, building in your body. And that's very bad. Like it can't go out. That's the problem if you don't exercise. And if you look at your body, it's like that saying goes, your body is made to move. Like it's designed to move. Like if you look at the whole structure of your body, you would see that it's really made to move. Like you have legs and you have all these body parts that are made for you to run, to move, to do stuff, not to sit in an office for, you know, the majority of your time. And I think that, I'm not sure who said that, but it's like, if you work 8 hours, like sitting in an office, even 2 hours at the gym won't fix that. So it's like that bad. It's, you're made for this and you shouldn't like sit all the time. So you're not designed to sit, but you're designed to move. Mm-hmm. That's why it's so important for you to move like daily, to go for these long walks. And it's beneficial on many levels. Like if you go for a walk, that's not just like your health. You think about ideas, it's a bunch of stuff going on. So it's not just, oh, I'm doing my health part. It's like on multiple levels.
Yeah, yeah. Some of my best ideas came while walking, especially when I was living in my beach apartment. I would just walk out of the house and in like 30 seconds, I'm like on the beach. So I would walk like 1 hour every single morning and I would have like the craziest ideas, just from that sort of mental quietude. Mm-hmm. And I also want to stress that, I mean, like I said, I work 18 hours a day, but I don't spend the majority of it sitting necessarily. So half of it I am sitting, which, you know, considerably a lot because it's like 9 hours, but the other 9 hours, it's usually when I talk to clients or strategize, I try to actually walk, you know, I just turn off the video and I just walk and sometimes exercise while talking to clients. And I would also love to get that. There's like a treadmill thing where it's like a treadmill and it's also a desk for a computer so you can work.
That's what Ty Lopez has. Yes.
Exactly. So, but the problem is that I'm traveling, so I don't know where I'll be and I can't like carry it with me. But yeah, that sounds cool. So it's like breathing, water, exercise plus taking out the bad food. And then there's like eating, you know, broccoli and all that healthy.
Yeah, exactly. So, the food would come last, but another thing that I would cover, which would be on productivity part, but it's also connected to health. So I'm going to cover it right now, which is your ultradian rhythm. That's what it's called. Like your body has like, I think it's like 300 rhythms or something. I don't have the exact number, which is like your breathing. Then it's like, your pulse, your heartbeat. Then it's like night day ratio, like you would supposed to sleep at night and then, be awake during the day. And then it's ultradian rhythm. And that's what most people get wrong, because the ultradian rhythm goes like you're up for like 2.5 hours. And then there's downtime for a half hour. Then it's like back 2.5 hours. Then it's right back down. And that's what most people drink coffee. Okay. So they feel like down, but they have to work. So they don't listen to their natural rhythm, which goes down. And they were supposed to take a break and just switch channels. That's what I call it, which is like, okay, you're doing some mental work, you're working on your business, and the way to switch channels is basically switch from mental to emotional, just talk for a friend and laugh, or, you know, switch from mental to physical, which would be like do some push-ups in between, like for 5 minutes, and then go back to work. But most people don't pay attention to that, and they just work on mental. They just burn themselves. And once they have no energy left, they just drink coffee on that to get just a few stimulus in their body and just keep working. And they burn themselves out because they don't listen to their body. So that's what ultradian. So it's basically 2.5 hours up, half an hour down, and then just keep repeating.
So you're saying that when you feel like you're tired, just get a fucking rest. Like just actually go to the side, you know, take a walk, read a book, talk to someone, laugh a bit. I mean, like, don't watch like YouTube videos, but like take some small break, right?
Yes. Well, I don't really watch TV or something like that. But if you watch TV, it's not like conscious. There is no effort. Like it's unconscious. You just lay back. And you don't use any of the mental muscles. So that's when it would be, I wouldn't say beneficial, but you would still kind of rest if you would watch like, you know, something that doesn't take a lot of work. But it would be even better to just switch channels. So from, you have like physical, emotional, and logical channels. So if you work on logical, then just switch channels. Just forget about work for a couple of minutes and just do, you know, push-ups or something. Just to switch and then switch back.
And what if I'm scared, for example, that let's say if I take like a 10-minute break or 15-minute break, then I'm scared that like I'll lose my ideas or I'll lose my momentum. Because that's usually where it comes from. It's like I'm doing. And then you kind of, you know, it happens to everybody. You kind of lose a bit of energy. And then you're like, no, I have to keep doing. And then you just, you know, because you're scared that if you'll stop, something bad will happen.
Yeah, but well, you know, you should write down if you think you would forget. But if you rest for like a few minutes, I think you will come back more productive. Okay, so it's like you're running and then you're just walking for a few seconds. You could run faster then because you're like, you know, you're like breathing and you're like slowing down and you're more relaxed now. Now you could go faster. So it's better, you know, just to take a few minutes of break.
I also believe that, you know, when you do something you're fucking passionate about, you know, then you take this break, this like 5-10 minutes break, and you know, you rest, but you do it consciously. You're like, okay, I have to rest. And while resting, all you can think of is like, I want to get back to it. You know, I just want to work. I want to keep doing it. You know, again, if you love what you fucking do, which is very important. And then just that, like, you know, it's funny, but it's like finally, like, you know, 5-10 minutes pass and you feel better. And then you're like, fuck this shit, just come back to work. And you're like, with all that energy, you know,
So
I could say, yeah, you could definitely say that I will even give you like a big boost instead of like, because what I notice is that sometimes, you know, it's, you know, when we work a lot, it's especially I work like on multiple channels. So it could be one time I could be focused on selling and making money, and then I could focus on the business and then designing something for the business. So it's constantly changing channels. And then I noticed that if I stay and keep working, even on my downtime, when I should take a rest, what happens is that I just lose focus. And then I could go on and start doing something that's completely a waste of my time that I would not do. I wouldn't even think about doing it if I was actually, you know, in my prime of work. But I would like focus on something stupid and waste my time on it. And not only that, I might even like watch like a YouTube video and just find myself wasting like 15 minutes on YouTube. And because I have no willpower at that point, because I used it all to like push through and keep working. And actually by that way, I lost more energy. I lost more time and I lost more work than if I would have just taken like a 5-minute break.
Yeah, exactly. I think that, not sure where I read that, but like the average tennis players, like in between those sets, they're just like all pumped up still, you know? So they never do anything different. They're just in the game. They're constantly thinking about it. But like the best players, like, you know, like Nadal, Federer, like those, the best players, they go to rest for like 30 seconds. They just unplug from tennis. They just, you know, just drink water. No, don't think about the tennis. And then they go 30 seconds and then they go back to play and they're much better. So that's what the best players do. And the average players stay tuned to tennis in between the breaks. So that's where, you know, it's between being average and being great, just keeping all those small things in place and really doing that. So I think that's very good.
Sounds good. So can you talk a bit more about food? You know, because this is kind of a controversial topic. So this guy says it's okay to eat meat. This guy says it's bad. You know, there's all sorts of different ideas. But what would you say are like the foundational stuff, like the stuff that, you know, no matter who you are, what you think, you probably should or shouldn't do?
Yeah, so it's like, you know, I do cheat meals, so that means that I also like to reward myself, I eat those foods. That's important to know. So I'm not completely cutting them out, but at the time that I'm working, I would completely cut them out. So I don't do that anymore. So keep that in mind. But you could reward yourself just to, you know, just it would taste so much better when you do that. Okay, so there are a lot of, you know, conflicting ideas, and everybody wants to speak about health, but you know, it's my ideas are not my ideas, but I read a lot of books, a lot of courses, and there are like four main poisons that an average human being eats, and I'm gonna just describe them for a little bit. So the first one is fats and oils. So you know, everything that's it's like fried or something that has oil in it, and the reason that's bad, it really changes. Okay, so it really changes it in a way that it's thicker and it has more acid in it. So that's what I'll be covering most. It is in all those poisons that I'm about to tell you, because you know, acid is like the worst kind of enemy, because it always attacks your weakest part. So whatever your weakest part is, your whole acid will go in there and just destroy it completely. So it's like you should really avoid acid, because it will kill you. Like even if you're like 4 years old, and we'll cover this later, but that's where most of even athletes or especially like bodybuilders get it wrong, is that by not doing the cardio, by not raising your heartbeat, because they want to gain like 200 pounds of muscle in a weekend, they just eat and eat and eat all this bad food, they raise their acid level. And what happens is, acid goes into your blood and it runs through your veins, and your body is naturally wired to survive. So it says, either I die right now because this acid would cut holes in my veins and in my bones, or I die in 3 years or maybe in 5 years. So what it does, it creates a natural cholesterol. So you don't even have to eat like a lot of cholesterol. It would create like its natural cholesterol and put it, inside the walls of your veins. So your veins would get smaller and smaller, less blood would go through, and eventually you would have a heart attack. And that's what's happened with, even people who are like 35, like 40 years old and look very skinny. It's not like you don't need to have like 300 pounds of fat to have a heart attack. It's like in your veins, that's the problem. Having too much acid, and then your body creates its cholesterol, and then you die. You have a heart attack because of it. And that's what most bodybuilders do. They want to gain muscle, while not running, while not being active like cardio wise. And the acid can't go out of their body. Like their body can't clean itself, because like it's not that big of a problem with blood, because the blood has a pump, which is your heart, of course. But other parts like liver, like all other organs, internal organs, don't have that. So like I said, your body is designed to move. So if you don't move, your body can't push those poison out of you. So if you don't, raise your heartbeat and just work out like running or something, which raises your heartbeat, those acid will, stick there and kill you eventually, sooner or later. So that's what it's really bad about that.
Yeah, well, you do know how to scare people, that's for sure.
Yeah, yeah.
How to scare them out of eating bad food. It's certainly worked on me, but I'm definitely not regretting it.
Yeah, so it's it has many benefits, and of course you get more productive, because what I will describe to you is all these poisons, and the more complex the food is, like with all this food that it's not natural. Basically, it's like genetically changed. Your body uses a lot of energy to process that, so it's like it's like the biggest consumer of your energy. So the more you eat that, the more energy your body uses. And even if you go to sleep, like most people go to sleep after lunch because they eat so bad that their body says, oh, look, you can't do anything else. I need the whole energy. So they're like tired and they have to fall asleep for a few hours and they're not productive. Like imagine how much you could do if you wouldn't sleep for 2 hours after your lunch every day. It's like so much difference.
Or if you didn't have that drop of energy.
So you feel really tired and you can't keep going, or maybe you push through, but you're not as productive because your focus isn't there. So I'm just gonna describe the other poisons, which are so we covered fat and oils. Now the second one is all animal products, which is basically all the meat, mostly because as I said, like in treat meals I eat meat, but not for the most part. It's like what you eat for 90% of the time, not the 10%. So the reason why meat, I think, is bad is because, like, when a lion eats a zebra or something, and when it kills it, it eats it right away, so it doesn't wait. It's like he kills it, and then he eats it, like, 5 minutes later. But what we do is we kill, and then it's, like, on shelves on a supermarket for, like, a month or two, and all the germs from the colon, all the germs are in colon, and then they spread out through the whole animal. So by waiting longer, the germs are everywhere. So there, if you eat it right now, and then they're everywhere. So you're eating all the germs, which are extremely bad. And another point on germs, it's like, this analogy about rats in New York. So, I'm not sure if they are in New York because I wasn't there for a while. So, but the point here is that rats don't go to very clean places and germs don't go to very clean places. So when people say, oh, there's all these bacteria and germs attacking me and I feel sick, that's because you're unhealthy already. So germs don't attack what's already healthy. They attack what's compromised. Okay, so if you're getting sick, it's because you were already doing something wrong before you got sick, not now. So it's not all these germs are flying around. It's like you're unhealthy, and that's why they're attacking you and making you feel sick.
You're the sucker.
Yeah. So
I never thought about it like this. That's really cool.
Yeah, so you're basically setting up the environment for them to feast in it. So that's the main thing that's bad about meat. And then another one is it's because all the adrenaline, like, animal is not stupid. Like, it knows that it's going to die, and it has all these hormones which go throughout the whole body. And, you're basically eating the fear of another animal, okay? So by you eating meat. And the third thing is, like, if you have meat, most people don't have, like, dry meat. Like, if you would suck all the fluid out of it, that could be, like, a little bit more healthy. And that's how some people eat it, but not the majority. Like, the majority likes these juicy steaks or this juicy meat, like in hamburgers. And the reason that's bad is I think it has the same texture as urine. It's like uric acid. That's literally how it's called, the thing that tastes good in meat. Like, if you would eat like dry meat, it would taste horrible. You would barely be able to chew it. It's like the worst thing ever. So by you having these juices, you're basically tasting the same thing that's in urine of an animal. So that's like the worst thing you could imagine by you seeing that hamburger there. So
you absolutely, like, you could do like vegan campaigns if you want. You would do like a really good job. Definitely after hearing that, I don't want to, like I said, since talking to you like a few weeks ago, you know, you talked about close to what we're talking about. And you also like use these really strong analogies and imagery. And definitely, you know, I stopped eating meat. I stopped, basically, what does stop eating meat mean? It means I just stopped buying meat from the supermarket, which is actually easier because meat, you know, you have to cook it and everything. And again, the only thing I eat right now is like fruits, vegetables, and fish. You know, and a bit of you know, like full bread and stuff like that. And I just feel good. I mean, I just feel, I don't have any more energy dips like I used to have, like these really long energy dips. I could have like a 3-hour sales call and just eat like 5 minutes before it, and I would not have less energy, because, you know, if you're eating like cooked salmon, or you're eating you know, only vegetables, and usually I like to combine them, then it's like really natural and your stomach is like, it takes it really well. And I also feel better. Like I don't know how to describe it. I just, in general, I just feel more awake.
Yeah, exactly. And the reason why most people, I think, eat this kind of food is health happens too slowly. Okay, so you don't eat like junk food, and then you're fat like after the 10-minute mark. So that's that's the thing about health. So you're eating it, and it tastes good. So you keep eating it, and your body is naturally wired to, like, if you were in a forest, like you have like a 10,000-year-old mind, and you know, 10,000 years ago you were in a forest and you wanted to consume everything that you had, because there is no guarantee that you would eat again in a couple of hours or days even. So you would just eat everything there is. And now when you go to like Walmart or something, there are like, you know, just a ton of calories everywhere, but your body doesn't know that. Your body doesn't know that it has, you know, unlimited access to those bad calories. So that's what it does.
It's not possible to die today from starvation if you live in if you live in a third world, in a first world country, you know, like United States or good countries in Europe, you can't die from starvation. It's literally not possible. Even the homeless people, you know, they have places where they can get food, or there's no lack of food.
Yeah, so I think the standard has changed. So it used to be like, you know, poor people are skinny and fat people are rich because they can afford food. But now it's like rich people are skinny because they can afford gyms and high quality food and all the personal trainers and all of that stuff. While poor people can, you know, afford chips and pizzas and everything like that, and they get fat. So the standard is now reversed.
The bad food so cheap? Why is it like cheaper to buy a hamburger from McDonald's than it is to buy like a broccoli meal?
Yeah, because you know, broccoli, if it's not like changed genetically, or if it's not wrong, it's like organic and it's hard to make. Well, all these foods are genetically changed, and they have like all these giant farms in the US, and of course I'm from Europe, so there are farms there too, and they figured out how to make things really cheap by changing the DNA structure. So if you have like a square feet of corn, like a regular corn, and then you have a square feet of their corn, which is genetically changed, you would be able to make about 10 to 20 times more of their corn. So they changed it so much that they could make, you know, like 1,000 to 2,000% more food in the same square feet now, but it's of course genetically changed and it's terrible. And they feed everything with corn, like they feed cows with corn. They don't feed it with grass because corn is now so cheap. And they put corn syrup and everything, like in cheese and in like yogurts and in everything. Even if you know, it's like salty, they still put syrup in it, which is, you know, sugar. It's you don't even taste it, but it's there. So it really lowers everything and it makes your body harder to process it. And I don't really know if they want to, you know, make people who are unhealthy and fat and all of that. I think that they just make food that tastes good because that's what people buy, you know, that's what people want.
They just want to make the most revenue. So it's like the lowest cost with the highest amount of buyers.
They're just meeting the demand, you know.
Yeah, and again, it has demand. Like they wouldn't, like people say, oh, you know, the internet is all shit because you get like all these scams and all these stupid articles that you need, that they want you to click on. You know, the clickbait. It's like, oh my god, what happened to that star? It's like, dude, the only reason they're doing it is because people are responding to it. If people responded to better shit, they wouldn't need to do it. Same with food. If most people would say, we will only eat good food, trust me, you would get broccoli for very, very cheap. They would find a way to make broccoli cheap. But since all you're eating is garbage because you're sort of surrendering to your natural urges, then again, they're not taking advantage of it. They're just, they want to make a living. So, you know, when you want to make a living, you have to sell something that people will buy.
Exactly.
So, yeah.
Yeah. So that's the problem. And there are basically three like time zones of food, which is like right now. So if you're thinking like from investor mentality, okay. So you have three time zones. You have right now, which is taste. So, you know, right now when you eat it and it tastes delicious, and then you have like in a few hours, like in an hour, and then, you know, through like 5 hours while it's being processed, and then you have like a lifetime. And if from 1 to 10, the food is like a 10 right now, there is like a great chance that it won't be a 10 right here when you'll need the productivity, or you'll go to bed because you'll be tired. And your lifetime, which is, you know, like we discussed, like, you know, all these health problems. So you can either choose like investor, like you can say like, you know, YOLO, you only live once, or some shit that's just stupid, and say, oh, I'm going to just eat food that's tasty. I'm going to just live for now. Or you can take the investor mentality and say, you know, I'm going to you know, invest and eat like not as tasty food right now, but I'm gonna have lots of energy down the road and I'm gonna live long and enjoy the rest of my life. So you can either choose this or this one. So you can choose both.
Yeah, also the whole YOLO thing, you know, just do it for now. That's the thing these people don't realize. They think they're so cool because they're doing YOLO and they're just doing whatever, and that's the kicker, whatever quote unquote they want. It's not just you're just surrendering to your DNA, and then you have like, you know, people take advantage of that and put you like, give you the worst shit ever. So you think you're going YOLO, but you're actually just eating shit that people are selling you, and you're excusing it by saying, oh, you only live once. You only live once, so live well. Like, don't eat. Again, if it was, you only live once, so I'll just eat whatever I want, but it's like good food, yeah, sure. But when you decide to live for the moment and just eat for the taste, you know, what's the best taste? It's usually the commercial products that will kill you, that you're basically making somebody rich while poisoning yourself. So you're just falling into the agenda. It's like people that are like anti-conformists. So you know, conformists are like people who do whatever like society tells them to do. And anti-conformists, they usually don't know it, but they're also conformists. because they also do what society says, but just the opposite. So if society said wanted them to do something, she does say like do the opposite. So always be aware of that. You know, as Ty Lopez says, if you play poker for like half an hour and you don't know who's the sucker in the room, you're probably the sucker.
Yeah, exactly. It's such bad because, yeah, exactly. Like you said, it's, they think they're being like creative, but they're just being led by other people. So it's really bad.
One last thing, we talked a lot about corn syrup earlier.
Yes.
So I just think it's very important to know that for anyone who's actually wants to check it out, you just go to your supermarket and you look at the products you have, even in your fridge probably, and 90% of what you bought, I can predict that if you look at the back, you know, the ingredients, you'll see high fructose corn syrup or HFCS. Yeah, high fructose corn syrup or HFCS. And that's, you know, when you see that, imagine that as if you translate it from high fructose corn syrup to don't buy this. This is garbage, basically.
I think that it's like 50 products out of 30,000 in a supermarket are actually healthy and don't have any of this stuff in it that I just described. So that's your chances of, you know, selecting the good kind of food. So it's less than, I don't know what's that like.
It's always, you know, you want to find the good food, always go to the corner, the parts where nobody goes to. Like, seriously, I go to every marketplace, to every supermarket, and I just get in there and I look where everybody is going, and okay, that's not it, and then you find like this dark corner with like spider webs and no lighting and nobody touched it in a long time, and there you see like vegan food, nuts, seeds, you know, you see organic fruit, organic vegetables. Basically, that you know, you have the whole supermarket, like this building, and then you have like this small, smart section for like healthy people, you know, these weird people.
Uh-huh. Yeah. It's not hard to be better than the masses, you know, because like conventional wisdom is almost always wrong. It's not hard to be better than the majority of the people.
Yeah. So, just take what everybody's doing and do it. Like most people buying that, don't buy that. Most people going to college, don't go to college. Most people tell you to make that decision. That means it's probably not the right decision. I like to say when you have a business idea, ask as many people as you can. And if you mostly get like, yeah, that's a great idea, like don't do it. Or the opposite. If you say, oh, I'm going to do it, and you have this crazy idea, and if people say, dude, that's crazy, don't do it, it's gonna fail, it's gonna be bad, you're like, I have the golden idea right here.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that's how I know. I'm not kidding, by the way. I do what I teach. When I have an idea and I hear a lot of people saying no, of course they have, you know, you have to be you have to think on your feet, don't be like a retard. You have to inherently know that it's a good idea. But if you do think it's inherently a good idea, then when I get a lot of no's, that's like, in my mind, it's like I get a lot of yeses. And that's one of the biggest secrets to my success, is that whenever a lot of people, especially my family, you know, depending on their mindset, but if you have like an average family with average values, if you have an idea and your family is resisting and saying that's not a good idea, don't do it, that usually to my brain translates as this is the best idea you can think of. And this hasn't failed me. And like I said, I spent over $50,000 on education, crazy, crazy, crazy adventures, crazy, bold decisions. And I can definitely say that right now I could not think of a better place I could be right now in my life in terms of finance, health, and all other aspects. While you look at all these people who told me don't do it, and you compare how much I'm making next to them, how much healthy I am next to them, how much I'm learning next to them, how much I'm happy next to them, how much passion I have next to them, And it's like every single aspect is like, there's no, not even a comparison.
Yeah, yeah. I think that it's very hard to start, like, because all the people are pulling you back who are next to you. Like, for example, you go to a restaurant and everybody orders pizza. You know, it's very hard to resist because you see all these plates of pizza and you want to eat it too because you're their friend and you're there and you're naturally wired as well. But once you start doing it, you can be an example of that and, you know, maybe change the standard, and then you know, it's just an upward spiral from there. It just changes you and you don't look back. So.
That's, yeah, eventually. I noticed you have like Tony Robbins, you have your shoulds and your musts. So So what happens is that as your shoulds grow, I should not eat that. I should eat healthy, for example. So you start eating more healthy. And then If you keep going down that road, you also start beginning to open a list of musts. It's like, okay, I will, and for me, it's like, I will never eat pizza. I will never eat junk food. I will never eat anything bad. And literally it's gotten to a point where I can't stay at like a pizza restaurant or a pizza or hamburger or whatever food it would be that's not healthy. And I will look at it and I would not even want it. It's not, you know, at first it's like, I want it, but I'm not going to take it. And then it's like, I don't even want to touch that shit. And I actually feel bad. You know, I see people eating it and they're like, oh, you're not eating it, you know, ha ha, ha ha. And they think they're so lucky. And all I see is like 20 years from now, I'm like a billionaire and they're like on their couch, fat and with their ugly wife. You know, not from the standpoint of like, you know, oh yeah, wanting it to be bad for them, but just like making a prediction. Like, yeah, you think this behavior is going to lead you to good places. You think you're smart by eating that pizza and laughing at me. You think that's the thing that's going to make you happy in life. Yeah, like you said, right now, yeah, it's tasty for the next 5 seconds, but what about the next 50 years?
Exactly. Like most people just fit in, like in a society, and you have to do, like you said, the opposite of what a society does. So it's kind of weird for everybody if you would, you know, just walk on the street and have an apple in your hand and eat an apple while everybody has like pizza in their hand. So it's like, who's that dude? Like, why is he eating an apple?
An apple is okay, but imagine if you walk and like you eat like a cucumber.
Yeah, yeah.
or even worse, you eat like broccoli or something, literally going, like walking in the street, you know,
why would anybody do that?
and yeah, but Cheetos, for example, that makes sense. Yes, so the Cheetos, yeah. If you did, then people would not think it's weird. But the funny thing is that also, you know, you're like, you make broccoli, and I like making all sorts of food with like broccoli. So I would even make like a broccoli salad, you know, a broccoli salmon salad. So it's like small pieces of salmon and maybe shrimps and like really good broccoli and all sorts of vegetables and fruit. And it's like this big bowl and it's incredibly tasty to me. And I would like go to people, hey, this is like the healthiest thing you can eat. Like, you know, sometimes they even put like kale in it. I go like, this is the healthiest thing you can eat. You want to bite? And they're like, oh, no, never. And then these guys are the biggest, like they eat like all sorts of bullshit. Ah, that's crazy, dude. That's so crazy. So yeah, at first you don't even agree to taking this sort of food because it's like, you know, and like broccoli, for example. I don't know if it's purposely done or if it's done, you know, because people just don't understand how people fucking work. But the way they market broccoli, always, 100% of the time on kids' shows, it's like you see broccoli as this like mean thing. It's like ugly thing. And then it's like, oh, but it's, and then they found out at the end of the episode that it's tasty. So what that means, usually, again, I was not stupid. I was a smart kid. So I said, okay, so they're presenting broccoli as this like really disgusting thing. And then it's sort of tasty. They're trying to trick me into eating broccoli. Why would you even in the first place consider broccoli, like show it on the TV like it's something bad? You know, just the way it looks, of all the ugly, it looks like a tree. It looks like you're eating a tree. and then you actually eat broccoli, and it's like this soft, squishy, mushy thing. It literally feels like you're eating, you know, like when you're eating like a filet, like you talked about, you know, when you eat the unhealthy shit, you know, the meat with all the pee, the urine or something you're talking about.
Yeah.
It actually feels just like that in terms of texture. And even if you like spice it up just a bit, like put a bit of pepper on it, maybe some garlic powder,
mm-hmm.
and maybe especially if you burn it a bit in the oven, it actually tastes similar to meat.
Exactly.
It actually is like the cool thing. You know, I would eat these things, I would go nuts, like broccoli schnitzel. You know, it's like this, it has a bit of crust, you know, and the crust is not the healthiest, so I scratch it off a bit. But it's okay, it's not that bad because the whole inside content is broccoli. I can eat these things like all day long. Yeah, I'm so happy that I discovered broccoli, because broccoli is like, it's literally one of my top favorite foods. Like next to sushi, it's probably my second favorite food in the world. And people don't know that. They think broccoli, they don't even show you in the TV shows and in the commercials that broccoli is like, it's soft, it's mushy, it's really fun to eat. It's not like the, like this, that's the way you should, like you're eating like a tree or something.
Yeah, exactly. So what I wanted to cover also is that the biggest myth is like, you know, if you would tell to an average bodybuilder or even an athlete, like, don't eat meat, and then he says, like, where should I get the protein? You know, it's like, I need the protein. And I think that most people eat too much protein, actually, because and proteins are in everything. You know, it's like 40% of broccoli is protein. Okay, so by you eating broccoli, you're eating a bunch of proteins. And even in like lettuce, you know, in salad,
yeah,
it's like 25% of protein. So it's perfectly fine. And, you know, like bodybuilders could get huge with broccoli and salad. They don't need meat, which creates acid. And then,
they might not get like this big, like the big ones, but trust me, there are many channels today on vegan bodybuilders, and literally these guys, some of them are enormous, like,
yeah.
And you know, they say, oh, but I want to be a bodybuilder. It's like you want to build muscles, you know, you don't want to be like that, like Jay Cutler, you know, have hands like the size of like two legs. And obviously when you eat meat, you know, it's like you said, it's sort of fills you up, so of course you're going to be much bigger, not necessarily stronger, but much bigger in the long run. But the thing is, the natural limit of being a vegan, you still have a very, very high natural limit. Like it's not like if you're a vegan you can't build muscle. You can build a shitload of muscle. You can build like at least 20 pounds of muscle, so you could get big, you know, at least 20 pounds. And it's clean big. It's not like big heart attack big. It's clean big, where you're like, where you actually built it with good protein, not like bad protein. So you're going to be healthier. And again, you would probably not want to go beyond that, you know. And if you wanted to, then again, it's possible. That's not even a limit. And the vegan bodybuilders, one last thing. The vegan bodybuilders, what I noticed about their body, and again, you can like look that up on Google. You can write vegan bodybuilder. You would see that they have like such nice cuts. Like you see like the shoulder blades and
it's like very lean, but very huge as well. It's
extremely lean. Exactly. Yeah. They don't have basically big, you know, bodybuilders that eat a lot of meat. They look like bulky. But then you take somebody who is like a vegan bodybuilder, and they actually look like very ripped, you know, they literally look ripped. You can see like every fiber, and you know, why is that? Because they don't have any fat. So it just looks really good.
Yeah. And the analogy that I gave you last time was like, you know, gorillas eat only bananas, so there's no like meat or we'll cover it later, like milk and stuff. And I still get a lot of proteins, and you wouldn't want to fight a gorilla. It's like very powerful, and you know, it's much stronger than a human. And it only eats bananas, which is like fruit. It's like only fruit. So that's quite interesting.
So yeah. One last thing. Yeah. So you say you have like a gorilla, which is the biggest animal in the wild, and it's this big. One last thing. There's this really big guy on this guy on YouTube who's like a huge sensation. He's highly controversial because he just makes constantly videos about dissing other bodybuilders about how they're giving bad advice and they don't know what the fuck they're talking about. And he's a vegan bodybuilder. He's been vegan since age 15. Since age 15, he's currently like 22. And just so you realize, this is how he looks.
That's awesome.
This is literally the guy. Entirely vegan. All he eats is like nuts and vegetables. And I'll just
awesome.
One more picture. He's like, that's him like half a year ago. So yeah, you can be a vegan bodybuilder for fuck's sake. Don't let that be your excuse to fuck up your health. And again,
exactly.
this is not a vegan lecture. This is a lecture about health in general. I also eat meat. I eat like fish. Mm-hmm. So probably we'll discuss that right now.
Yeah. So the biggest point that you can take from this is the difference between health and, you know, just let's say looking good by being a bodybuilder and, you know, putting all this poison in yourself. I would pick health every time. Like I would be the smallest guy if I had the choice, I would be the smallest guy that has the most energy and is the most productive and do things, you know,
And you don't even need to make that choice. You can be
exactly.
healthy and look huge. Just not have a heart attack and be
like the only thing you have to avoid is that urge of, you know, eating meat and just switch and create a habit of eating other things. So, and another point here is, you know, like everything has its frequency. So your body, your whole organs have their own frequency, and it's about like 70 megahertz. So your like liver or your kidney has like 70 megahertz, like frequency. And all the food have frequency, but like if you eat Big Mac or something, it has 5 megahertz, and you have liver that has 70 megahertz. So by having this huge gap, like we had one gap before, which was like your average American diet has 15% of water and it's 70%. Now we have another gap, which is 5 megahertz. And here we have 70 megahertz. And this gap causes aging. So if you eat like Big Macs and meat and all this bad food, you will age faster. You would see, you know, your skin and your whole body age faster. But, you know, looking at, you know, like Matt, he looks a lot younger than he is. And everybody, you know, that take care of themselves and don't have stress and eat like that will stay, you know, they will look like 35 when they're 50. While people that will constantly eat like Big Macs will look 50 when they're 30. So that's the difference. And, you know, most of the, you know, vegetables like broccoli have about, you know, from 50 to 70 megahertz, and almonds and all sorts of nuts have about that, the same amount of megahertz. And then if we look at the, you know, the wheatgrass, it has 120, and all the, you know, the green drinks that you mix have about the same amount. And if you smell a rose, it actually has 320. So that's the experience of you smelling a rose, you know, a flower. So that's another thing you should keep in mind, because I think aging is extremely important for whether you're a male or a female. You want to live, you have, you know, to enjoy the money you make or the things you create.
So you say that you have the bad foods and that age you much faster and fucks up your brain. You have the good food, which is like broccoli, you know, clean meat, stuff like that, which is actually keeping on the natural course, and you'll be able to live long. And,
yeah.
And then you have like the when you're like a health freak, or like when you really want to look good, you can eat like the high megahertz things, and these things are usually disgusting unless you know how to make them. Because I used to drink like green shakes every single day, and when you learn how to make them properly, it's like the tastiest thing in the world. I would love it so much. So you're saying when you drink these things, like the green shit, you know, that nobody eats, like 10% of the people are like vegan, but like 1% of the people actually eat the green shit. That's not only healthy, that's also anti-aging. So that actually has
exactly.
a reverse aging effect.
So that's the difference. Like you mix like broccoli and kale and everything in one cup, and then on the other cup you have soda. Like 99.9% would pick the soda because it's all sort of sugar. But if you pick this one, you live much longer, have a lot more energy, just plus, everything will be good.
Okay, sounds good. What else do we have to cover? Because we have like maybe 21 minutes.
Okay, so the third thing is dairy products, which are, you know, all the milk, all the cheese, all the yogurt. And most people like that. Like, I used to drink lots of milk. And there's a common myth that, if you eat drink lots of milk, that you have stronger bones. Well, it's actually in reverse, because it actually creates lots of acid, which drains the calcium from your bones and making them weaker. So the more milk you would drink, and especially the milk in the supermarket. Okay, we're not talking about organic and healthy kind of milk, because there are none in the supermarket usually, because it goes through a few processes that aren't very healthy. So your bones are actually weaker the more you drink, and that's the main thing that when you get older, you basically shrink, you become smaller. And that's the reason why, because it leaches, the acid leaches from your bones, and they become smaller and smaller. And, as reserves drain out, you become weaker, and then you just fall and you break something right away. So that's what happens as you get older and filling yourself with acid. And basically cheese is like concentrated milk. It's like 4 times worse than milk. And, I used to love cheese. Now it's on my cheat meals. So I eat it like twice a week, maybe, or not even that. So, it's kind of hard to make the switch because you're so programmed to do it. But if you think about it, we didn't used to drink from the cows. Like, if a goat would drink a cow milk, that would be weird. Like, if you would see in the nature, like another animal drinking from some other animal's milk, that would be weird. But somehow it's totally normal if we do it. So, just because somebody does all the work for you and brings milk to your home, that doesn't make a difference. Like, if you would see a cow, you wouldn't go drink from it. So, it's like not different if somebody else does the work. So that's the main point from here. And then we have the fourth thing, which is probably what not most of the people here do, which are, entrepreneurs and like more evolved people. And these are drugs. And that's, any kind of drugs, like alcohol. And then there's, smoking, which is also like pure acid, like nicotine. It makes you addicted, and it gives you acid, which is, for bad for all of these reasons. And what most people do is coffee, of course, because there are all sorts of articles describing that coffee is good. Well, that might be true for some sort of coffee, but that's not true for like Starbucks or something. It's like the worst thing you can do it, because actually caffeine and all sorts of creams, that's again pure acid. So it really destroys. And you see all those like young girls who are in their 20s or even teens who just starve themselves. Like, they want to stay skinny, and they just go to Starbucks, and the only thing they do is they drink coffee and talk. You know, it's like the worst thing you can do if you're 20 years old, like, you know, only drinking coffee and not eating. It's pure acid. It's, you know, it just destroys you, and you're, you know, barely 20 years old, and you're already making all these bad decisions. So that's really something everybody should avoid.
Yeah, absolutely. Like I'll mention that for the last time. Since I'm working 18 hours a day, you know, I had a period where I drank a lot of coffee because I, quote unquote, I needed to drink a lot of coffee, you know, to keep up with the pace. And what would happen, at first I did get a bit more energy for the first few days, and then it started like lower and lower returns. Not only that, now I needed coffee. And not only that, I started having these weird heart, like literally these weird feelings in my heart, like as if the heart is beating too fast or something is not right. Like I have too much adrenaline. I'm like, you know, all on edge, you know, like that, like, duh. And then I stopped drinking coffee, and of course it felt bad for a few days. And then today, you know, when I want energy, I just go and get myself dark chocolate or something.
Yeah, exactly.
And I don't have any more energy dip. So I don't like work and suddenly I need coffee. It just doesn't happen. I work, like I said, if I can work 20 hours a day, 18 hours a day, nonstop, basically, no coffee, you know.
Yeah.
No reason. And I'm not like an over energetic person. So there's no reason anybody would not be able to work in an 8-hour day in an office without coffee. It's purely psychological addiction.
Yeah, exactly. So they work for 8 hours and they need lots of coffee and they drink more and more of it because it's low return and it's like a drug. Like, you know, some drugs are illegal, but coffee is legal and it's still a drug. And then most people say like, oh, that's not a drug. And, you know, it's perfectly fine if you drink it. Like, it makes no sense if you think about it. And alcohol is like pure poison. It's like, if you would just pour, you know, the whole glass of poison that goes straight into your blood, changes everything in your blood, destroys all the organs. And if you only feel a little bit more relaxed, it destroys like 100 million brain cells, which is like a crazy amount of brain cells. And, you know, some people would need their brain cells, like, and they're just destroying them every Friday, and it's just a crazy amount.
Yeah, it's funny how usually the people who need the brain cells the most are the ones who...
Yeah, exactly.
It's kind of ironic, you know. I also see that a lot. Let's say I go to, like, a party or something, or a concert. You know, you would always see that funny scene. You would see that really, really obese guy with his obese girlfriend. And, you know, you see them going to order some food next to you, and you just know what they're going to get. You know, you just know that they're going to get something really bad. And you see them coming with, like, this big thing, like that. And it's like, you know, I have the privilege of eating one of those, but I will never touch one of those. And you are desperately in need to stop eating them, but you're eating them every day. So it's like the irony of obesity and lack of health, you could say.
That's like the main reason why, you know, rich get richer and poor stay poor, and, you know, healthier, like healthy people get healthier while, you know, more unhealthy get even more unhealthy. So it's like in all the areas, like the people that need it the most will usually do something bad and keep doing it, while the people that are already doing good things will keep doing it and keep evolving and growing. So
yeah, but again, it's like the it's like all in your head. That's the cool thing. Yeah. Like, it's all in your head. So, you know, you're like a poor person, you don't have a problem, you can get salad, you know, with all due respect. Yeah. You can always buy salad. It's not more expensive than buying like a hamburger, you know. You can always buy the salad. You can start buying, you know, read, go to the library, read books. You know, we have so many cheap options. You have YouTube, for God's sake, with like millions of lectures and like the most successful people in the world literally explain you things and talk to you.
Exactly. even if you're completely broke, like library is free. You just go there and you read.
That's why I have no sympathy for poor people. Like, okay. I get that there are some special backgrounds, there are some special cases, but the majority of cases, I guess. Yeah. Okay, if you live in this country, if you live in a first world country, then I have no sympathy for you. You know, if you live in a third world country and somebody raped your mom, or you live in a field, you know, you don't really have access to anything.
But if you have like a health condition of some kind, it really limits you.
Exactly, you know? Exactly. Yeah. And even that people overcame.
Like Richard Branson.
Richard Branson, or I think even worse, like Helen Keller. Was literally born blind, deaf, and mute. And she wrote like books that are to this day some of the best books you could read. And she said that the only person who's worse off than a blind man is a guy who has no vision. And that came from a woman who cannot speak or see or hear. And like you really want to think about this. That like, if you have a fucking cell phone, there's no excuse. If you have a cell phone,
yeah,
you know, a smartphone, and you're not successful, you have only yourself to blame. Only yourself. Because people, you know, they complain, I don't have money.
They have victim mentality.
It's the government. It's the this. Yeah, but like, have you done everything in your power to make it happen? You know, okay, so as Benjamin Graham, I think, said, or I think it was Benjamin Graham, he said, we are taxed, by the government, but we are taxed twice by our idealness, three times by our laziness, and like four times by our lack of taking action. So yeah, you are taxed by the government, but if you don't, you know, take action and actually, you know, take advantage of your situation. Again, you're living in probably the best time to ever live. You have access to all the information you could want, and you have all the potential opportunities. Like 100 years ago, if you're a black or if you're a woman, you had 0% chance of becoming successful. And 200 years ago, there was like a 0% chance, no matter what you did, unless you were born into royalty, or if you're like one in a few million people who somehow managed. But today, like, everybody can become a millionaire. Everybody can be healthy. Everybody can excel. So you literally have no excuse.
So I think that's the main reason why, if you get successful and you have people, you know, who are like average around you, like they can't manipulate you anymore, and they can't tell you stories why they can't do it. Like if they say, oh, it's the government, that's why I can become successful and healthy and all this. And then you become successful, they can use those stories on you. So
that's why they stop associating with you.
Yeah, yeah.
Really?
They can tell you.
the best way to lose a lot of friends is to become successful very fast.
Yeah.
That's the best. Cool. So Mitja, do you have any other things you want to go for? We have just a bit more time.
No, I think we, I'm not sure. I think we covered the basic part.
Pretty much covered everything. Okay, so let's do like a quick wrap up. So breathe properly.
Exactly.
Drink more water. Do cardio every day. So even like 10 minutes, 15 minutes, just do some workout.
Clean yourself up, yeah.
Yeah. Take out the bad shit. That means look at the back of the thing and look if there's high fructose corn syrup, and use your fucking logic. If most people are buying it, it's probably shit. Yeah. If 90% of the world eats that, you know, 90% of your town eats that, then you're just moving forward to being like 90% of your town, which is probably unsuccessful, not happy. So you want to do things differently, or you'll get the same results as everybody. So you have clean out the bad food. And then once you reach that point, you know, you can even start experimenting with like, green shakes, eating grass.
Yeah.
Stuff like that. And what would you say would happen to a person who actually implements this? And let's say a year from now, he's doing all of that perfectly. How would you say that will change his life?
that would be the foundation of everything, because I think the health is like the best investment that anybody can make. Like I mentioned before, people just want the business part, but they forget the physical and emotional. And everybody who's just starting out, or if you're already successful, it's like the most measurable results. And if you like start business right now, you might not see like money results tomorrow or like in a week, but if you start the health right now, it can start changing right now. So that's the beauty of it. It's like the best investment that you make. And another analogy that I make is, you know, I ask people like, would you rather have $1 million and your legs? I mean, $1 million and without legs, or would you rather have no legs and $1 million right now? So most people would take the legs and no money. And that basically means that they value their legs over $1 million. So their legs are worth more. And they, you know, if they had like a car who's worth that much, they would, you know, maintain it. They would take care of it. But somehow they think that it's just given to them. Like their legs will be there forever, but they would go down in value, of course, if you don't take care of them. Like you would get fat and they would get weaker and, you know, they would break because of the bad bone structure eventually. So you have to take care of it like they're worth more than $1 million, because not everybody has legs. And if you have it, you're like even fortunate to be alive, and then you have legs, and then you live in a first world country. Like that's, you're so blessed by having that. And, you know, and you have to really take care of that. So
absolutely. Yeah. All the options are there. You just have to, to decide to use these resources, and they're actually not more expensive. You know, it's a lot more expensive to eat like organically, but you don't need to eat organically. You just need to stop eating shit and start putting like good things in your body, which are about the same price. You know, it doesn't cost that much more to eat broccoli at the supermarket than to get a dairy product or something.
Yeah, it takes such little more effort to become above average. You know, it's not like a lot. It's just a little bit better, and you're above 90%. So it's
the bar is so low today. Literally, you could eat just a bit healthy, be a bit innovative, and you'd make so much more money and be more healthy than everybody else. The bar is that low, basically. That's we live in a cool society, full of suckers, basically.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's pretty much it for today, I guess. So Mitja, thank you very much. And anybody here who wants to contact Mitja, you know, you have my resources at the bottom of the page. You can feel free to contact him and have Mitja, you know, personally coach you and mentor you in order to actually build a more successful, healthy foundation. And also, we will have another guest appearance probably regarding the topic of productivity. So definitely, I recommend you check him out, maybe even have a consultation session with him and see how you two can work together to become more healthy, productive, and successful. So thank you, Mitja. And good talk. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.